This Filmmaker IQ lesson is proudly sponsored by Rode Microphones, premium microphones and audio accessories for studio, live, and location recording. Welcome to FilmmakerIQ.com. I'm John Hess, and today we'll dive into the history of frame rates. Let's establish a basic truth about film. Nothing in the movies is real. The sets are fake, the actors are pretending and reciting lines written for them. Even the very essence of moving pictures is a lie. There's nothing moving. It's all an optical illusion. Take, for instance, this spinning wheel of circles. Now, it looks like it's moving in a clockwise direction. But if we compare each frame of this animation, we see that actually nothing is moving at all. We're just turning off circles sequentially. But when we flash this illustration one after the other, our brains create the sense of movement. Now, this is called the Fee phenomenon, first described by Max Weidhelmer in Gestalt Psychology in 1912. The human brain can perceive about 10 to 12 individual frames per second. Now, faster than that, and our brains blend the images together into motion. So we found our first frame rate, anything higher than 12 frames per second. Simple, right? Well, not so fast. With film, we need to stop the projection, stop the light, as we load up the next frame. Otherwise, we have just a big blurry mess. But playing back 12 frames per second with 12 intermittent periods of black as the film advances will create an intolerable amount of flicker. How fast do we need to flash the images on screen to make that flicker disappear? Well, according to Thomas Edison, the magic number is 46 times per second. At 46 frames per second, our persistence of vision kicks in, and we won't notice the screen going dark between every frame. But 46 frames per second meant you had to run through a lot of film, and that stuff isn't cheap. Film projectionists came up with a unique solution. Let's flash the same frame on the screen more than once. Using double or triple bladed shutters, you could up the frame rate projected without running more film. Playing back a 16 frames per second film using a triple bladed shutter, we would flash each frame 3 times for a total of 48 frames per second, just above Edison's recommendation. And that right there is our first commonly used frame rate for silent film, 16 frames per second, or thereabouts. The inconsistency of silent film frame rates have driven film historians and preservationists nuts. Early 20th century cameras and projectors were hand cranked, and cinematographers would undercrank or overcrank the camera for effect. D.W. Griffith was notorious for undercranking his shot, shooting as low as 12 frames per second. Even Edison ignored his own recommendation. Exhibitors also played fast and loose with frame rates, sometimes playing back films faster so they could squeeze in one extra showing at the end of the day. In reality, silent film frame rates could range anywhere from 14 to 26 frames per second, but that was okay because it really didn't ruin the effect of motion pictures. Well, that is until sound came into the picture. The introduction of sound was one of the most drastic technological and artistic changes in all of motion picture history. Now, because sound was recorded as an optical track that ran alongside the film strip, recording and playing back film had to be kept at a very strict and even frame rate. And that frame rate would be established internationally in 1929 as 24 frames per second. Now, why 24? Well, they found that the audio track just didn't have enough fidelity on a 16 frames per second system. Using 48 projected frames as our goal, they stepped up to the next factor, a 24 frame system using double bladed shutters to create a desired 48 projected frames per second. So why 24 and not 23 or 25? Well, that comes down to basic math. 24 is a number that can be easily divided by 2, 3, 4, 6, and 8. So an editor can know right off the bat that half a second is 12 frames, a third is 8 frames, a quarter is 6 frames, and so on. Now, why not a higher number like 30 or 32, which also have those same factors? Well, like I said earlier, this stuff ain't cheap. 24 frames was just the lowest, easily divisible number that would work for sound. Ironically, the need for a consistent 24 frames per second created headaches in the sound department. The first sound cameras with their whirling electric motors were very noisy, forcing camera operators to shoot from a soundproof booth through a window. Technology and design did eventually catch up, but the 24 frames per second frame rate is still very much with us today, almost a culturally ingrained in what we come to expect from a cinematic experience. Television had to deal with the same flicker issues that plagued motion picture film, but flashing the same frame on screen was not an option that was technologically feasible. Engineers were more concerned about bandwidth, something they were trying to conserve with over-the-air broadcast television. Well, the solution was developed independently by German Telefunken engineer Fritz Schroeter in 1930 and in the U.S. by RCA engineer Randall C. Ballard in 1932. To conserve bandwidth and avoid flickering, each frame would be interlaced, that is, broken down into two alternating fields, an upper and a lower field. Each field would then be created on the screen, one after the other, in a comb-like pattern. And in order to eliminate intermodulation, that's the beating distortion caused by the hum generated by the electrical current, the refresh rate was set to that of the AC power. In the United States, 60 hertz. So each field is created in a 60th of a second, resulting in a full 30 frames per second. But the story gets more complicated with the introduction of color. In 1948, the FCC put a moratorium on new television broadcast licenses as it tried to figure out what to do with the newly available UHF spectrum. The idea was to introduce a new color system utilizing this higher frequency bandwidth and let those older VHF channels which the older TV sets could access, let those die off. While they were trying to figure out what to do, TV sales went through the roof, exploding from 1 million sets to over 10 million in a matter of just a couple short years. The idea of letting those older VHF TV stations die off became impractical. So now the race was on to create a color standard that was compatible with the older black and white TV sets. The NTSC, the board that created the first US TV standard, reconvened with RCA, leading the way using a system first outlined by Georges Valenci in 1938. Breaking the image down into luminance and chrominance, broadcasters could embed a color signal as a sub-carrier in the television signal. New color TVs could pick up and interpret this color sub-carrier, which would just be ignored by the older black and white TV sets. Well, so far so good. But there was one small problem. The bandwidth used by the color sub-carrier could potentially interfere with the audio signal and cause intermodular beating. The solution would be to reduce the frame rate by a factor of 0.1%, 1/1000th, phasing the color and audio signal so they would never fully match up. In December of 1953, the FCC adopted the RCA system for color broadcast, and we go from 60 fields per second down to 59.94 fields per second for an effective 29.97 full frames per second. In a mathematically ingenious way of creating signal for both color and black and white television sets, we have these oddball frame rates that are still a big part of modern broadcasting standards. But that's only if you live in a country that uses the NTSC standard. In 1963, German television manufacturer Telefunken released PAL to the European Broadcasting Union, with regular broadcasts in PAL starting in 1967. PAL was a format designed to solve the color problems that plagued NTSC and would work with the 50 hertz AC power used in Europe and elsewhere in the world. PAL, along with a similar format CCAM, run at 50i for an effective 25 frames per second. So how do we get the cinematic 24 frames per second to fit onto a 60i video stream for, say, watching movies on video. Well, let's walk through the process. First, the 24 frames per second is slowed down by 0.1%, giving us 23.976 frames per second. Now, if we do the math, we can see that we need 4 frames of 23.976 to fit into 5 frames of 29.97. Now, we do this by splitting the frames up into fields using a 3-2 pull down. The first frame is captured onto 3 fields, the upper, lower, and then upper field. That's 1 1/2 frames. The next frame is captured onto the following 2 fields, the lower and then the upper. The next frame after that fills up the lower, then the following upper and lower. That's 3 fields. The last frame filling up the upper and lower. So we have 3 fields, 2 fields, 3 fields, 2 fields. That's the 3-2-3-2 cadence. Unfortunately, this process isn't perfect, with resulting video having that telescene judders every 3 frames, which is especially noticeable on long, slow camera movements. Now, reverse telescene or reverse 3-2 pull down are technologies that work backwards, constructing a true 23.976 or 24p video stream from the 3-2 pull down 60i footage. Most modern digital cameras avoid the telescene process altogether and record 23.976 or straight 24 frames per second natively onto the hard drives. But there are workflows out there that run videos through HDMI cables, which are rated for 60i, and they may utilize the 3-2 pull down. For telescening films onto PAL or CCAM's 25 frames per second, the process is actually much simpler. Using a 2-2 pull down, the 24 frames per second footage is sped up by 4%, and each frame is transferred onto 2 fields, an upper and a lower field. The increased speed raises the pitch of the audio by a noticeable 0.679 semitones, or a little more than a quarter step musically, but that can be adjusted down using a pitch shifter. 24 frames has been the standard for narrative film for nearly a century now, but enterprising filmmakers have tried to push the temporal resolution or frame rate higher, trying to reduce motion blur and create smoother and more realistic look. One of the notable experiments in high frame rate is ShowScan, a 70mm format developed by visual effects wizard Douglas Trumbull, who's famous for developing many of the visual effects for Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey. Running at 60 frames per second, ShowScan created a stronger biometric response in test audiences. But the process just never found use in narrative film, being used mainly in motion simulator rides. More recently, Trumbull has worked on a digital ShowScan, shooting at 120 frames per second and adjusting the playback anywhere from 24 to 120 frames, depending on the needs of the shot. But audiences just haven't been warm to the high frame rate in narrative film. The most recent experiment was Peter Jackson's The Hobbit, presented in 48 frames per second. A Variety reviewed the film and complained that the human actors seemed overlit and amplified in a way that many compared to modern sports broadcasts or daytime television. One projectionist complained that it looked like a made-for-TV movie. But filmmakers at the technological bleeding edge, people like Peter Jackson or James Cameron, still push for higher frame rates. Will the future of narrative filmmaking leave 24 frames a second behind? The technology is already here. The new 4K standards are capable of up to 120 frames per second. Now, while these high frame rates may be great for recreating the immediacy of sports broadcasts or really good 3D or for video games, to this filmmaker, there's something cinematic about the cadence of 24 frames per second. For all its drawbacks in clarity and motion blur, it's just how we grew up watching movies. Now, maybe the next generation will grow up with high frame rates and see 60p as the new cinematic look. Or maybe not. Frame rate is the engine behind this cinematic lie. The magic trick that allows us to enter a world that's not quite real, but real enough. A simple defining number shaped by psychology, economics, clever engineering, all in service to the act of telling stories. So use it. Use that engine and go make something great. I'm John Hess. I'll see you at FilmmakerIQ.com.